After all these prerequisites on unbounded operators, self-adjoint operators, and the theorem of Stone, which relates unbounded self-adjoint operators with strongly continuous unitary groups, we are now ready to go back to maybe one of our main concerns, namely the canonical commutation relations. So in principle, we are interested in operators, self-adjoint operators, which satisfy the relation that their commutator is a multiple of the identity. That's what one also in physics takes somehow as the basis. That should be the momentum and the position operator which describe physics. So we want to understand what possibilities are there for having such operators. Are they unique? Is there only one possibility, or are there more? And yeah, indeed, there is a very big difference between the case of finitely many particles or degrees of freedom and infinitely many. Okay, and first we will start with the finite dimensional or finite case, and this essentially is the same as just having one particle or one degree of freedom, so we will look on this. Okay, and later we will then go over to infinitely many, which corresponds more to quantum field theory considerations, and there the situation will be very different. But first we look on the more classical quantum mechanical situation. So this is about CCR, canonical commutation relations, and a reformulation of this into terms of the unitary groups. And then those guys are called Weyl relations. Yeah, so let me recall what I mean with the canonical commutation relations. So this means I have two operators, which I call P and Q, and they should stand for momentum and position operator, but I mean, yeah, the physical interpretation is not so important for us. We just want to know what kind of properties should they satisfy, and those are these CCR relations. So we want self-adjoint operators, call them P and Q, which, yeah, so we say such two operators satisfy the canonical commutation relations and this is quite a mouthful, so usually we just say CCR abbreviation, canonical commutation relations. So the canonical commutation relations, yeah, if they satisfy this algebraic relation that their commutator is minus I times the identity, but since we have to allow unbounded operators, maybe it's also the question where does this make sense? Unbounded operators are not defined everywhere, so we should make somehow sense of this by working on domains where this equation really can be applied. So let us here also require that they are defined on a dense domain, and both should be defined on the same dense domain, because otherwise I mean I have a relation which involves both of them, and I must specify on which domain should this be valid, so there should be one domain, so they are defined on a dense subset in my Hilbert space. Okay, so those are operators on Hilbert space H, and I want there to be a dense subspace D such that my operators are defined on D, and they might be defined on bigger things, but at least they should, both of them should be defined on D and also map D into itself. And then on this D, I can require that they satisfy this CCR. So namely, the commutator between them, PQ, so the commutator, so this is just an abbreviation for PQ minus QP. So this should be the identity, okay, if those guys are self-adjoint, it should be minus I times the identity. And yeah, I mean, on this side, of course, this makes sense everywhere, but here I can only apply this to elements in D. And now you see why I require things like this, because if I act on D, P sends this to D again, and then Q can also act on this. And the other way around also. Okay, so this is the canonical thing which I should require, at least, that this definition makes sense. So this should make sense on D. But of course, unbounded operators are tricky, so we will later on rewrite this in a form which involves the bounded operators. Okay, but let us start from this, because that's what you usually want, in particular in physics, and actually in physics you also have a constant here, so usually you have this h bar here. So in physics we would require that the commutator is actually equal to minus I h bar times identity. And h bar is a physical constant. But we don't bother about this. This is, of course, just a matter of renormalizing things, so we can put h bar equal to 1, or just ignore it there. Good. So that's what we want to understand. In particular, we want to understand how many, which possibilities are there to find operators like this, and how many. And first of all, our motivation at the very beginning was that there are no bounded operators which do the job. So we really have to look into unbounded operators. And that was the reason that we did all those things about the unbounded operators. So let me remark this again here. So the first remark, so as we know, and we did this in 3.2, so this was the motivation at the beginning of the chapter on unbounded operators. This was the reason that we had to look on unbounded operators. So we know there are no bounded operators satisfying this. So there are no bounded realizations of the CCR relation. Good. Okay, so we have to look on unbounded operators. And maybe let me now reformulate these relations in a way which you also find very often in physics, but also from a mathematical point of view. You can say I have here two self-adjoint operators, but I can also put them into one non-self-adjoint operators by declaring them to be the real part and the imaginary part of this. And then I can just rewrite. Instead of having two self-adjoint operators, I will then have an operator, which I am going to call A, and I have it together with its adjoint, and then the relation between P and Q just goes over to a relation between A and A star. And so let us look on this. And that's a very common way. What you do in physics, and what we get are very prominent operators there. So namely, so we put those P and Q as real and imaginary part in an operator which I'm calling A. So let's say A, so this is Q plus I times P, and then let me take a normalization which I'm taking here as square root of 2. And then of course the A star of this is Q plus the adjoint of this, I mean Q and P are self-adjoint, so the I gives me a minus I, so I have Q minus I P divided by square root of 2. Okay, so this is just the definition of rewriting the pair of operators into one operator, but then I have to look on its adjoint, so I'm replacing the pair QP by the pair AA star. Okay, but then the relation translates into something nice, namely then I have the commutator between A and A star. That's the only meaningful commutator. I mean, the commutator between A and A, and A star, A star, A star is of course 0. But the commutator between A and A star, so what is this? I have here, for both, I have the 1 over the square root of 2. So together I get a 1 over 2. And then I have the commutator between A and A star, so the commutator is linear in both arguments, so I get a commutator between QQ, between QP, PQ and PP. And of course QQ and PP, this disappears, so the only terms are the gross terms, so from here and here I'm getting a minus I and the commutator between a Q and P. And then the other way around, from here and here, I'm getting a I and the commutator between P and Q. So plus I, the commutator between P and Q. Yeah, and so now what is this? So by my definition of the canonical commutation relations, the commutator between P and Q is minus I. So P and Q is here, so this here is minus I. And the commutator between Q and P is of course minus the commutator between P and Q. So this here is minus I. And so, so this is plus I, so this is the minus of this, so this is I. And so you see what I have for both terms is I times I and a minus sign. So I times I is minus 1, the minus sign gives a plus 1, and here the same, so I have 2 times plus 1. And the normalization, you see now why I have chosen this, because this gives me now exactly 1. Yeah, so you see, rewriting the CCR relations into this form gives me also very nice relations, and maybe those are also relations which are very often used in physics, which probably you have seen before, namely that the relation between A and A star is equal to 1. So this is just a rewriting, but it's a form which is for many purposes maybe easier to deal with, or it might be, it's at least as important as the other one. And then we will also look on this. So the CCR relation can, in terms of those operators, rewritten as the commutator between A and A star is equal to 1. Good. And maybe in this form, I can also make a short remark that actually, those here are relations which refer to bosons, the normal particle in physics. But then, of course, there are also particles which are fermionic, which have maybe like spin or something like this, and they are given by relations like this, but the commutator is replaced by the anticommutator. Okay, so that's nothing which we will talk more about. So essentially, we only talk about bosons, but I just want to point out, as this remark here, that there is also a fermionic analog, and actually it's best to write it as a fermionic analog of this. So there is also fermionic analog of what we have here, which one would call bosonic situation, and this is called, because it involves not the commutation relations, but the anti-commutation relations, this is called the CAR, canonical anti-commutation relations. So CAR, so this stands for canonical anti-commutation relations, and again, it is defined, let's say, in terms of an operator corresponding to A. Maybe I'm calling it B now, but the relation is not in terms of the commutator, but you replace this by the anti-commutator. So you want the anti-commutator, which I denote by this curly bracket, so between B and B star. And this is just a notation for the anti-commutator. Anti-commutator means instead of minus, I'm taking a plus here. So I'm taking a BB star plus B star B, and I require that this should be equal to 1. So you see, it's the same relation. I mean, this relation here, of course, maybe I write it really what it means. So this is A star minus A star A is equal to 1. And now I just replace the minus by a plus, then I have the canonical anti-commutation relations. And in this case, actually, it looks very similar. But the situation is quite different because there are bounded operators which satisfy this. And they are even very small bounded operators. Namely, you can realize this by 2x2 matrices. And then if you are dealing with those fermions, then all these problems which we have with unbounded operators usually don't show up. So the situation, in a sense, is there much nicer. Write this down. So those relations, the CAR, they have bounded realizations. So namely, you can realize them on a two-dimensional Hilbert space, and they are given corresponding to 2x2 matrices, which are of this form 0, 0, 1, 0, and the B star, then of course, is just flipping, taking that joint, the transpose, complex transpose, so B star is just 0, 1, 0, 0. And if you multiply them, I mean, if you multiply B, B star, you will get one on the 2-2 entry, and if you multiply B star B, you get a one on the 1-1 entry, and if you add them, you get the identity matrix. So those two guys satisfy exactly this. Yeah, and they are describing bosons, and no, fermions. Okay, yeah, but so we are not follow up on this, but what we really want to understand are the CCR relations. Where A star, the commutator is equal to 1. And first of all, maybe we should recall that, of course, we know at least one realization of our CCR relations, namely the Schrödinger representation, which is given by multiplication and by derivation operators. And somehow the main question which I want to address and answer in this chapter here is whether there are any other representations of this.